this evening, because yet again I've got some terrible news for you. Tonight what we're going to do is horrible. It's the worst album I've ever purchased. Now I'd just like to go by a couple of rules here. The first rule is there's times when we have to go and buy for relatives, you know, like granny wants a record she's heard on Pebble Mill or some bullshit like that, you know, daytime TV. And, you know, and she, ooh, I heard this one on the early morning TV advert. Ooh, blah, blah, sings Christmas hits, blah, blah, blah. Ooh, right. Yeah, I'll go down the shop and get it for you. There's also singles which we've bought. Now, I should cover all this as quickly as I can, but what we're dealing with in particular here is an album which you have gone into a shop and ended up buying for yourself and then really regretted it and thought, I've done some stupid things in my life, but this could possibly be one of the worst things I've ever done. I am ashamed, I'm embarrassed, and hey, fuck it, I'm going to tell you guys what it is. But, you know, the wonderful Matthew Street, I was watching his video, it started a bit of a buzz off in the vinyl community, and does Paul McCartney sing like he used to? Here's a quick answer to that. This is a tape recorder in my head. This is from 1976, Paul McCartney singing Maybe I'm Amazed. Maybe I'm amazed at the way you love me all the time. Really, really love me. Okay, now this is from 2008, Paul McCartney singing the same song. Maybe I'm amazed at the way you love me. I rest my case. I wouldn't pay fucking 1.5 shillings to see that cunt now. That's it. All right, anyway, let's get on with the show.
Who is it?
Anyhow, where do I begin? Well, I think probably, you know, in the league of the really bad albums I've actually bought for other people, I think the worst one ever was my granny. You know, there was this woman called Jane McDonald's, fucking big nose, fucking, and she ain't no Barbara Streisand, even though she tries to be a Barbara Streisand. She's some fucking cheap daytime TV whore who got popular on another daytime TV series about a cruise ship. And she's been hanging around in the background ever since. Anyway, my nan, she says to me, oh, can you go down Woolworths and get that, you know, that lovely girl who lives with her mum? And she, fuck it. So I said, all right, Nan, yeah, of course I can. Yeah, I love my Nan. I'll do anything for her. God rest her soul. She's not with us anymore. But this was in the days when Woolworths was around. And now Woolworths, or Woolies as we called it, now they'd have album after album of, you know, actors turned singers, fucking forgettable stage people, albums, you know, they'd just come out, be advertised on early morning TV. Of course, granny would think, oh, I want that. Michael Ball, oh, he's so handsome, he's lovely. Yeah, fuck Michael Ball and his bullshit. Love changes everything. Fuck him. But anyway, this was the worst one I ever bought. Check it out, kids. Also in the running, I'm not saying whether I actually bought these songs or not, but in quick succession, you can see the kind of quality that was going on. And I'd like to just mention that I might have been dabbling in drugs at the time, which hindered my judgment, let's say. Right, here we go. Roll Supersonic.
Oh,
You never close your eyes anymore when I kiss your lips. And there's no tenderness like before.
It's a 10 out of 10.
What? I love you deep down.
Well, I'm glad that's over with, but I'm afraid to say I've saved the biggest turd till last, and this really embarrassed me. And just quickly tell you the story behind it. I was more innocent back at this point because I'd heard this song, "When Love Breaks Down, Ding." When love breaks down, ding. Now it kind of got into my head a little bit, and I thought, oh, that's all right. Never bought the album or nothing, yeah. But I thought, well, I'll get you. Anyway, this particular band, they'd done a follow-up album to that first one. And anyway, I was in the record shop, and this is a dangerous thing, so don't fall for it. If you hear an album playing when you're choosing records, you know, you're having a look around and you hear, and then, ooh, who's this playing now? And then I say, oh, that's such and such. And yeah, I'll have that as well. You know, I've got a few spare quid on me. I've bought what I'm really coming to get. But this was the extra album I bought because I had a bit of cash on me at that particular moment. What sold it for me was this. They were playing a sort of video in the background as well. I said, just look at us now. We're growing.
Look at us now.
We're growing.
Some things hurt more, much more than cars and girls. Just look at us now. What adds up the way it did when we were young?
I'll just introduce it, all right? I'll introduce it. Here we are. This is the worst album I've ever purchased. Right, well, the album was by a group called Prefab Sprout. Now, I want to give you a little bit of background behind all this, because it's not so much that the album is the worst one I've ever bought, but it's the arsehole who's the leader of the band, and he's just made it into this... Excuse me, I've got to pick my nose. He just made it into this dreadful, like... I'm the best songwriter in the world. I mean, the guy, he's called Paddy McAloon. I mean, that's a stupid made-up name if ever I heard one. And what's more shameful was that the Beatles have inspired him, and it's just done terrible damage because, you know, you get these people and they're just sort of like, well, my brother, we found out recently that he's autistic. He's 5 years older than me, but he's always, oh, you know, I've done this, I've done that. Oh, I'm wonderful. Now, the bloke's been out of work for most of his life, and yet he'll go to parties or he'll go to family gatherings. They say to him, oh, so what are you doing now? Oh, well, I'm keeping an open mind at the moment. It's the lucky employer that's going to get me, you know, and... It's narcissistic behaviour. That's a big word, but I want you to hear it again. Narcissistic. And also, even more serious, megalomania. Megalomaniac, right? Now, these are two very damning words. And for younger viewers that don't know what they mean, it's basically people who do nothing but talk about themselves. I mean, us in the vinyl community, yeah, we're a little bit narcissistic. We are. Well, let's face it. We're blowing our own trumpet. I mean, Larry Graves, I know he's a bit mental, but I mean, he is a narcissist. But these are people who just sing their own praises all the time and don't really notice really talented people or dismiss talented people as, you know, pointless. And anyway, the thing is, this guy, Paddy McAloon, now, I didn't know at the time when I bought the album, but he was on interviews on the radio and interviews on TV. Was Oh, you know, I mean, I'm the best songwriter in the whole world. You know, I've just done blah, 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 blah. And he's really stick by that. And when people took the piss out of him on other shows to say, "Oh, didn't you say that you was writing better songs than like Lennon McCartney and every," and he'd sort of be all coy and say, "Well, I know it sounds pretentious, but I really did think that."
Some people, of course, could accuse you of digging your own grave in that some of your press statements have been quite provocative. You've said that you consider yourself to be one of the best songwriters in the world, for example. How much of that is purely self-belief, and how much of it is just trying to sort of grab the headlines?
Well, I don't think I'm really very good at grabbing headlines. I come out with those sort of statements and then immediately back off. I can give you examples where if you came to me and said that you didn't really rate me, then I would probably, metaphorically speaking, go for your throat by saying I was a genius. But if you said to me you were possibly the best songwriter I've ever heard, then I would say, oh, no, no, and I would list you the people I like. I suppose it's a psychological defense mechanism that you say one thing to me, I feel as though I've got to balance it out. Now, those statements about being the best songwriter in the world, I did say that because, this will sound terrible, because in 1985, I felt that nobody made a better record than us. And this is so hard to explain. I don't say it because I think I'm brilliant. I just felt that, hey, I liked Steve McQueen as a fan. It was as much to do with Thomas Dolby as it was to do with me. I got that finished record and thought, dear God, how did it end up sounding so good? That was my honest thought. But
And I still do think that. Now, this bloke's getting worse and worse. Not only is he a funny-looking fucker as well, the whole band come from County Durham, and that's full of fucking inbreds. So, I mean, down the sliding chart, it's not looking good. But, you know, I hate it. This mixture of narcissistic behaviour and megalomania is a dangerous, terrible thing. And when you get the finished result, I mean, you'd be expecting like something like Abbey Road. Nothing of the sort, mate. Nothing of the sort. Now, this, you'd probably know this. I mean, you know, if Paddy McAloon could stand up and say in front of the world, I'm the best songwriter ever, I'm brilliant, you know, we're going to be the best band in the whole world, and we are the best band in the whole world. Now, you might think there's a little bit of chance, there might be a bit of chart success to go with that. Well, the only chart success they ever had in the singles chart was a top five hit, which is this one. Well, you know what I think about frogs, but I think the kids like this song because it's got that, you know, catchy hook to it. You know, it's easy to sing along, but I don't think that's what Paddy wanted. I think Paddy was thinking more of something serious, but oh, it's fucking dreadful. You know, frogs, jumping frogs. And I had a fat friend once and he didn't know the words. If you don't know the words, you make them up, but he said, hot dog, jumping frog, have a cookie. Yeah, I mean, shit, pile of shit, pile of shit. And that was the most successful record they ever did, the most successful song.
Never liked that anyway, is it?
Not really, no. I'm always defensive about my work. I'm never, now I could, you know, I could have to be bold. I tend to get arrogant if I meet someone who would maybe say something about what I do. That is, if they were kind of defensive, but that quotation that we're talking about here is where I said, oh, I'm the best songwriter in the world, which I made to a guy who actually likes us very, very much indeed.
Well, English people this refers to more than anything else. You know, when you're at school or when you're at work and somebody, and back in the 80s, it wasn't that common for people to go on holiday to America. You know, we all went to Spain and Portugal and places like that. But, you know, America was a little bit off the beaten track for most people. But then they started doing the cheap trips to New York and the cheap trips to Florida. but you'd still get these fucking idiots, and they'd come in all shapes and sizes, and they'd go to America, and they'd come back 3 days later, or 10 days later if they were in Florida. Oh, and they were all bloody Uncle Sam Yankee Doodle, swinging a baseball bat, fucking, what is it, quarterbacks. Oh, you know, chewing gum and saying, oh, yeah, oh, what did I just say? Oh, I meant pound, not dollar. And they'd come with this stupid transatlantic accent, act like total cunts, like, oh, God's sake, give me a break, will ya? You think you're fucking Christopher Columbus just because you spent 10 fucking days at a bloody £200 bloody holiday? It's, you know, you'd never get John Heaton behaving like that. You know, he'd go out there, he's Lord of the Manor. Oh, yes, thank you. And then the Americans would respect him back for being a classy dude. But when they get these fucking chavvy families going over, going, oh, it's Mickey Mouse over there. And then they come back and then they're sort of talking transatlantic accent. Like, sure. Oh, I just picked this accent up while I was out there. And then, oh, for fuck's sake. And I couldn't mention them. No, I will. Alan McCartney and Andrew Dixon. These people, they come in to work and they're just... And you think, for fuck's sake, get a life. Anyway, you wouldn't expect this from such a rock legend as Paddy McAloon, but it's the case. That's what he did. He's went to America, he's acting like, oh, America, oh, it's the Statue of Liberty. Fuck's sake. I mean, we taught the Americans what culture was. Don't fucking shove us some cheapy bloody Statue of Liberty up your bloody nose. Or Vampire State Building. Dah. Anyway, listen, I'm not even going to review this one. I'm going to let... You remember Susie and the Banshees? I'm going to let Susie Sue do all the talking. Please forgive me for this next 3 minutes.
Guess what? Summer's arrived. The world's on my side.
The torture's over. Oh, God. Oh, isn't that the most Oh, well, it's just a
Go on,
question
get
of taste.
Out.
It's
get
just
the
a
knives
question
out,
of taste.
Please. Come
but
on.
I had to watch that with a bucket when I first saw it. It's so awful. I mean... sort of it's like halfway between a grimace or a smile, and I'm sure they don't know the difference, and they've never reached a fall either. And it's just disgusting, it really is.
Strolling Fifth Avenue just to break Sinatra's been here too.
Oh, Paddy McAloon, I saw him on the box the other day.
Oh,
say,
Pop's most watchable man.
Oh,
isn't he gross? I mean, that is a prime example where you shouldn't see, you know, the mind behind the hits. Or, I mean, I think music's
disgusting. So what exactly do you object to? The fact that he's very bland and sort of sugary sweet?
Well, of all the songs about Manhattan, I mean, that doesn't tell me anything about Manhattan. And that's such an insight. It's so half-baked. It's so wishy-washy and whimsical and... I just find it so emotionless. There's no character. I just find it nauseating.
It's quite strange because he was actually raving on about that song supposed to capture that moment of being alive and being fresh and a new,
what,
exciting
that is?
Play. Yeah.
God. Yeah, I mean, they look like, you know, they've escaped from Stepford Wives. It's like my worst nightmare. It's supermarket music. It's like the trolley sort of floating around, you know, and they're on the top there. Oh, it's horrible. That is the worst.
He's a very outspoken man though, isn't he, old Paddy McAloon? In fact, we wanted to get him to come in. I mean, he sort of like speaks, but not on TV. He wouldn't do a video view because he didn't want to speak about anybody else's work.
Well, I understand that, but I mean, everyone's got an opinion, I suppose, you know, if you want to be liked by everyone, you know, you don't want to be that honest about things.
Hey, Manhattan,
he said that he thinks that Pop's power to change things is now gone. It's finished. I mean, what do you?
What would he know? Blimey. But some days you've got to get outside.
Well, I mean, as you can see, the band are an outrageous embarrassment. And, you know, I mean, I don't hate the band themselves. Paddy McAloon, yeah, he's a complete... You wouldn't want to meet him. You really wouldn't, because he'd be going... Nee, 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 nee. And he's still doing it. Years later, you know what? The band split up. All the members left. Even his own brother left the band. And that girl with the funny eyes and the flaky voice. They'd all gone. And he's still going 10 years after this. He's in an interview. And he's saying, oh, there's still room at the top. But you haven't had a top 10 single ever apart from one. Oh, yeah, yeah, well, I've got my Sergeant Pepper coming up. And then, you know, I did a bit of YouTubing and I found... He's still banging on. He's just on his own now. He's still got Prefab Sprout as the group. And he's still going on about how he's going to change the world. He's on this sort of, you know, anti-Trump mission at the moment because it's probably popular. Oh, I mean, God help us. God help us. America. Well, that's it. I mean, I would really like to hear, if you've got the guts, if you've got the guts and you're honest enough, tell me, you lot out there, Mayo, Heaton, Rock Boy, Russ Goodall, and Matthew Street, and Ty Died, I would like to hear what you think. Or you remember as the worst album you ever bought and really regretted. Really regretted.
Yeah, just altogether pointless.
Anyway, there's just a question I would like to ask before I leave today. If a killer whale shouted for help, how far do you think he could be heard, I wonder?
Well, no one is sure yet. We do know that they can make signals to other whales miles and miles away.
With no cable or long-distance charges either.
Yes, Mr. Whale. Let your fingers do the walking.